Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents HBR Guide to Finance Basics for Managers by Harvard Business Review, narrated by Jonathan Yen. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material.
What you'll learn. Where do you begin if your boss asks you to prepare a break-even analysis? Can you tell the difference between an income statement and a balance sheet? Between gross margin and revenue? Do you understand why a business that's profitable can still go belly up? Has your grasp of your company's numbers helped or hurt your career? If questions like these make you sweat, you've come to the right place. This guide will give you the tools and confidence you need to master finance basics, as all good managers must. You'll learn how to speak the language of finance, compare your firm's financials with rivals, size up your vulnerability to industry downturns, shift your unit's focus from revenues to profits, use financial data to defend budget requests, avoid running out of cash and going out of business, keep costs from killing your bottom line, invest smartly through cost-benefit analysis, sell your brilliant idea with ROI, avoid putting too much faith in the numbers. Section 1. Finance Basics. Don't be afraid. What's the ROI on that software your department wants to buy? The CFO says profits are great, but money's tight. Everyone needs to conserve cash. I've been studying the figures, and it looks as if your sales reps are sacrificing gross margin for revenue. Have you talked to them about that? Our inventory days are creeping upward. We have to find a way to reverse that trend. I'm worried about our business. The financials suggest that corporate isn't investing in our future as much as it used to. Every corporate manager hears questions and comments like these, sometimes from a boss or a finance director, other times from colleagues in water cooler conversations. Whatever the source, they all have one thing in common. They take for granted that you understand the fundamentals of finance. The people doing the talking presume that you speak the language, that you can read the financial statements, and that you can use basic financial tools to make decisions. But what if you're not sure of the difference between an income statement and a balance sheet, or between profit and a positive cash flow? What if you can't define inventory days or days sales outstanding, and you don't know how to use those numbers to improve financial performance? If someone asks you to prepare a return on investment, ROI, analysis, do you get a sinking feeling in the pit of your stomach because you have no idea where to begin? Don't despair. For one thing, you're in good company. Financial trainers Karen Berman and Joe Knight reported in Are Your People Financially Literate? That when their Los Angeles-based Business Literacy Institute administered a 21-question quiz on financial basics to a representative sample of American managers, the average score was only 38%, a failing grade in any classroom. After listening to this introduction, you'll have a chance to quiz yourself with a short sample of similar questions. At least those managers did better than the group of Fortune 500 officers and directors described in Andrew Ross Sorkin's New York Times article, Back to School, but this one is for top corporate officials. On another, equally basic, test of financial concepts, these executives scored an average of 32%. But there's another reason not to feel too bad. You can easily remedy your situation. Listening to this guide is a great start. The first section introduces you to the key terms and the three main financial statements. The next section shows you how to use some of the essential tools of finance. Learn these, and you'll be able to make better decisions to improve your unit's performance. The final section steps back from the numbers and emphasizes the importance of keeping your wits about you. Finance is partly science, to be sure, but it's also partly an art. And when you apply its tools, you have to be sure you understand the context for what you're doing. Why bother with all this? The reason is simple. Every business runs on financial data. If you don't know the tools of finance, you can't put that information to work. If you can't even speak the language, you'll be left out of the larger conversation about your company, and your career may suffer as a result. When you finish this guide, you'll be well on your way to understanding and using the tools and the language. You'll also be well positioned to take a couple of advanced courses, so to speak, by turning to sources that dig deeper into the subject. Do you worry that financial concepts will be too complex, or that you won't be able to do the math? Rest assured, learning the fundamentals of finance is not the same as studying to be a numbers pro. People typically go to school for at least a couple of years to become financial experts, and then they spend a lot of time picking up specialized knowledge on the job. This guide won't give you all that. It's just about the basics, and the math involved in using financial tools is relatively simple. Most of the time, it's no more complicated than the arithmetic you did in middle school. The stuff that's a little trickier can easily be done on a computer or calculator. Ready to begin? Take the quiz that follows. The answers are at the end of the guide, but don't check yet. Instead, take the quiz again after you've listened to all the articles, and then compare your two scores. You should be pleased with what you have learned. Chapter 1. Finance Quiz. Do you know the basics? This 10-question quiz isn't designed to measure your entire financial IQ, but it will give you a sense of the fundamentals you should learn to become a more effective manager. When you finish listening to this guide, you'll have a chance to retake the quiz and compare your scores. If you don't know an answer, just mark it "don't know" rather than guessing. That will give you a clearer indication of your progress later. The questions here were developed with the help of the Business Literacy Institute in Los Angeles. A more comprehensive financial IQ test is available for purchase at www.business-literacy.com. 1. The income statement measures A. profitability, B. assets and liabilities, C. cash, D. all of the above. 2. A sale on credit ends up on the income statement as revenue and as what on the balance sheet? A. accounts receivable, B. long-term assets, C. short-term liability, D. operating cash flow. 3. What happens when a company is profitable but collection lags behind payments to vendors? A. the company is okay because profits always become cash. B. the company stands a good chance of running out of money. C. the company needs to shift its focus to EBIT or EBIT. D. the cash flow statement will show a negative bottom line. 4. How is gross profit margin calculated? A. COGS divided by revenue. B. gross profit divided by net profit. C. gross profit divided by revenue. D. sales divided by gross profit. 5. Which statement summarizes changes to parts of the balance sheet? A. income statement. B. cash flow statement. C. neither of the above. D. Both of the above. 6. EBIT is an important measure in companies because A. It is free cash flow. B. It subtracts interest and taxes from net income to get a truer picture of the business. C. It indicates the profitability of a company's operations. D. It is the key measure of earnings before indirect costs and transfers. 7. Operating expenses include all of the following except A. Advertising costs, B. Administrative salaries, C. Expensed research and development costs, D. Delivery of raw materials. 8. Owner's equity in a company increases when the company A. increases its assets with debt, B. decreases its debt by paying off loans with company cash, C. increases its profit, D. all of the above. 9. A company has more cash today when A. customers pay their bills sooner, B. accounts receivable increases, C. profit increases, D. retained earnings increases. 10. Which of the following is not part of working capital? A. Accounts receivable. B. Inventory. C. Property, plant, and equipment. D. All of the above are part of working capital. Chapter 2. The Key Financial Statements. What does your company own, and what does it owe to others? What are its sources of revenue, and how has it spent its money? How much profit has it made? What is the state of its financial health? You can answer those questions by turning to the three main financial statements: the balance sheet, the income statement, and the cash flow statement. These are the essential documents of business. Executives use them to assess performance and identify areas for action. Shareholders look at them to keep tabs on how well their capital is being managed. Outside investors use them to identify opportunities. Lenders and suppliers routinely examine them to determine the creditworthiness of the companies with which they deal. Every manager, no matter where he or she sits in the organization, should have a solid grasp of the basic statements. All three follow the same general format from company to company, though specific line items may vary depending on the nature of the business. If you can, get copies of your own company's most recent financials so that you can compare them with the sample financials discussed here. The balance sheet. Companies prepare balance sheets to summarize their financial position at a given point in time, usually at the end of the month, the quarter, or the fiscal year. The balance sheet shows what the company owns, its assets, what it owes, its liabilities, and its book value, or net worth, also called owner's equity or shareholder's equity. Assets comprise all the physical resources a company can put to work in the service of the business. This category includes cash and financial instruments, such as stocks and bonds, inventories of raw materials and finished goods, land, buildings, and equipment, plus the firm's accounts receivable, funds owed by customers for goods or services purchased. Liabilities are debts to suppliers and other creditors. If a firm borrows money from a bank, that's a liability. If it buys $1 million worth of parts and hasn't paid for those parts as of the date on the balance sheet, that $1 million is a liability. Funds owed to suppliers are known as accounts payable. Owner's equity is what's left after you subtract total liabilities from total assets. A company with $3 million in total assets and $2 million in liabilities, has $1 million in owner's equity. That definition gives rise to what is often called the fundamental accounting equation. Assets minus liabilities equals owner's equity, or assets equals liabilities plus owner's equity. The balance sheet shows assets on one side of the ledger, liabilities and owner's equity on the other. It's called a balance sheet because the two sides must always balance. Suppose, for example, a computer company acquires $1 million worth of motherboards from an electronic part supplier, with payment due in 30 days. The purchase increases the company's inventory assets by $1 million and its liabilities, in this case its accounts payable, by an equal amount. The equation stays in balance. Likewise, if the same company were to borrow $100,000 from a bank, the cash infusion would increase both its assets and its liabilities by $100,000. Now suppose that this company has $4 million in owner's equity, and then $500,000 of uninsured assets burn up in a fire. Though its liabilities remain the same, its owner's equity, what's left after all claims against assets are satisfied, drops to $3.5 million. Notice how total assets equal total liabilities plus owner's equity in the balance sheet of Amalgamated Hat Rack, an imaginary company whose finances we will consider throughout this chapter. The balance sheet describes not only how much the company has invested in assets, but also what kind of assets it owns, what portion comes from creditors, liabilities, and what portion comes from owners, equity. Analysis of the balance sheet can give you an idea of how efficiently a company is utilizing its assets and managing its liabilities. Balance sheet data are most helpful when compared with the same information from one or more previous years. Amalgamated Hat Rack's balance sheet shows assets, liabilities, and owner's equity for December 31, 2010 and December 31, 2009. Compare the figures, and you'll see that Amalgamated is moving in a positive direction. It has increased its owner's equity by $397,500. Now let's take a closer look at each section of the balance sheet. Assets. Listed first are current assets, cash on hand and marketable securities, receivables, and inventory. Generally, current assets can be converted into cash within 1 year. Next is a tally of fixed assets, which are harder to turn into cash. The biggest category of fixed assets is usually property, plant, and equipment. For some companies, it's the only category. Since fixed assets, other than land, don't last forever, the company must charge a portion of their cost against revenue over their estimated useful life. This is called depreciation, and the balance sheet shows the accumulated depreciation for all of the company's fixed assets. Gross property, plant, and equipment minus accumulated depreciation equals the current book value of property, plant, and equipment. M&A can throw an additional asset category into the mix. If one company has purchased another for a price above the fair market value of its assets, the difference is known as goodwill, and it must be recorded. This is an accounting fiction, but goodwill often includes intangibles with real value, such as brand names, intellectual property, or the acquired company's reputation. Liabilities and owner's equity. Now let's consider the claims against a company's assets. The category current liabilities represents money owed to creditors and others that typically must be paid within a year. It includes short-term loans, accrued salaries, accrued income taxes, accounts payable, and the current year's repayment obligation on a long-term loan. Long-term liabilities are usually bonds and mortgages, debts that the company is contractually obliged to repay over a period of time longer than a year. As explained earlier, subtracting total liabilities from total assets leaves owner's equity. Owner's equity includes retained earnings, net profits that accumulate on a company's balance sheet after payment of dividends to shareholders, and contributed capital or paid-in capital, capital received in exchange for shares. The balance sheet shows, in effect, how its assets were paid for, from borrowed money, liabilities, the capital of the owners, or both. Historical cost. Balance sheet figures may not correspond to actual market values, except for items such as cash, accounts receivable, and accounts payable. This is because accountants must record most items at their historical cost. If, for example, a company's balance sheet indicated land worth $700,000, that figure would be what the company paid for the land way back when. If it was purchased in downtown San Francisco in 1960, you can bet that it is now worth immensely more than the value stated on the balance sheet. So why do accountants use historical instead of market values? The short answer is that it's the lesser of two evils. If market values were required, then every public company would be required to get a professional appraisal of every one of its properties, warehouse inventories, and so forth, and would have to do so every year. A logistical nightmare. Where are the human assets? As people look to financial statements to gain insights about companies, many notice the traditional balance sheet's inability to reflect the value and profit potential of human capital and other intangibles. Remember that the intangibles included in goodwill appear only when one company acquires another, and that the figure represents only the acquiree's intangibles at the time of purchase. The absence of intangibles from the balance sheet is particularly significant for knowledge-intensive companies, whose skills, intellectual property, brand equity, and customer relationships may be their most productive assets. Indeed, a study several years ago by Baruch Lev of New York University found that 40% of the market valuation of the average company was missing from its balance sheet. For high-tech firms, the figure was over 50%. So managers and investors must look beyond the bricks and mortar, the equipment, and the cash that constitute balance sheet assets to determine the real value of a company. How the balance sheet relates to you. Though the balance sheet is prepared by accountants, it's filled with important information for non-financial managers. Later in this guide, you'll learn how to use the balance sheet ratios in managing your own area. For the moment, let's just look at a couple of ways in which balance sheet figures indicate how efficiently a company is operating. Working capital. Subtracting current liabilities from current assets gives you the company's net working capital, or the amount of money tied up in current operations. A quick calculation from its most recent balance sheet shows that Amalgamated had $1,165,500 in net working capital.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.